happy Sabbath. Pearl was supposed to be Halcyon. I'm supposed to be Pearl today. That's what every good husband does, stands in when his wife is running behind. What a day for her to do that. But anyway, it was for good cause. Our announcements today. First off, Jonathan, he's back in the back. You said something about God's closet. The date is July the 24th.
Yes.
It was listed as the 17th, but now it's the 24th. Yep. Okay. Elders meeting today at 12:30 in the church library. We also have children's Sabbath school lunch and Sabbath school council meeting at 12:30. Oh, here comes Pearl. She decided to give me relief. I need all the help I can get.
Happy Sabbath. I am glad that all of you are here. Now, I hope that I remember everything that everybody else told him. I haven't had a chance to read the bulletin. So you know what? Don has an announcement he wants to make. I have a couple that I was asked to make. If Jeff has not already told you, we will not have the mother's prayer after church. Tracy will not be doing that this week, and look in the bulletin next week. Which reminds me, you know, when people say, well, I didn't hear about this, that's because you were given this beautiful thing and you probably didn't read it. So, if you want to be in the know, I found out that teenagers actually read this thing. I found that out last week. A lot of them actually do. So if you want to be in the know and know what's going on in the church, guys, read your bulletin. Because I can tell you, I'm not always going to remember to tell you everything that's in here. And there's a lot of stuff in here. The other thing Halcyon wanted me to tell people this week is that for the respite for Steve Johnson's funeral, it will just be for the family. We're not going to have the normal potluck that we have, so it will just be for the family. Also, if you're interested in women's retreat, we will know more about it, but know that once we get all the information, we have to have it in by September the 15th. Now, aside from that, I've already said welcome, but I just want you to know, if you don't have a home, a church home, you just found yours. And I don't know, I know most of the people because I've been here for forever. I must have forgot something because he's coming back.
No, I was just going to say, both of us were here on Wednesday night. I think we had a half a dozen people here for prayer meeting. Now, come on, we can do better than that. Look at you today. And what a blessing the midweek service is. So if you have the opportunity, I know some people live far enough away that it's just not convenient, but we're also putting it out on the live stream. So be sure to tune in if you can't come here and join us for a wonderful time. Our pastor is doing a wonderful job with that.
All right. So whoever you are, whether you are with us online or here in person, I cannot read lips and body stuff. But anyway, whoever you are, you're meant to be here. God wanted you to be here today, and I'm glad that you listened and you came. He loves you, and if somebody's not here, well, let's just pray they'll be here next week. Or call them when we get home. I've already seen somebody I gotta get in touch with. Just standing up here. So look around, and I haven't forgotten about Don. Look around and see if there's somebody that's missing. And if they are, go home, call them, text them, send them a note. Say something. Say, I am so glad to know that you're a part of this family, but I sure didn't miss you today. Because, you know, the thing of it is, we all sit in different places, and we know who sits around us. We don't always know who sits behind us. I used to know everybody that was missing because Jeff and I sat practically on the back row. Now we sit on the front row. I don't know who's here unless I'm up here like this. But anyways, I'm going to let Don come up and do whatever it is he's going to do, and then I'll finish.
Good morning, church family. I wanted to share with you an event that took place yesterday. Our family was invited to the Kernersville Fire Department to participate in a ceremony honoring my late father-in-law, Ollie Clark. And I just wanted to share with you, he received this award, this plaque, and it actually, in the past, it was called a Medal of Honor, and they changed the name of the Medal of Honor to the Chief Ollie Clark Medal of Honor yesterday. So I know that Ollie has been resting in the Lord for a number of years, but a number of you probably remember my father-in-law here in this church. He was a quiet, unassuming gentleman, didn't have a lot to say, but when he did, it was profound, and it registered with those in his hearing. He served as the church treasurer here for a number of years, and it was Ollie that got me involved in the leadership here in this church. He was asked to, after he had retired as the treasurer in the church, he was asked to chair the finance committee, and he agreed to do that if I would do the talking for him, which, you know, was kind of a little bit odd at the time when I'm always so nervous to be the one talking anyway. But he was a leader in a very quiet way, and he had a profound effect on my life, and I'm sure many others. And it's just, it's as we are approaching our homecoming here in a couple of weeks. Valerie, are you going to talk about homecoming? Is that something that you're going to talk about here this morning? No. But I would just want to you to know that you know, we're going to be having our homecoming here. I believe is it the 30th of July? And if you know of someone that is a past member or some individual that had a profound effect on your life, let it be known. What is the saying that most Adventists know? We have nothing to fear for the future except that we forget how God has led us in the past. And I just wanted to share this event with you to tie that in with the homecoming here. If you know someone, make sure they're aware of, invite them to this event, and I thank you.
Pastor asked me to highlight one more thing. Steve Johnson's funeral or celebration of life will be at 1:00 on Monday, and then they'll have a graveside right after that. Once again, welcome to Kernersville. I'm glad you're here, and I know you're going to get the blessing the Lord meant for you to have. Thank you.
As I look out, I see pretty much everybody here is either a member or, you know, frequent visitor, so you pretty much know what comes next. This is the time when we meet together in the front here, those of us who have special burdens that we want to bring to the Lord in our garden of prayer. And there's a lengthy list in the bulletin, as Pearl mentioned this morning, of those who are requesting special prayer. But I will ask you this morning, are there unspoken prayers this morning that we'd like to bring to God this morning? What a blessing it is to be members of the Kernersville family of God. And I invite you to meet us in the front now as we seek the Lord in prayer. Gracious, beloved Heavenly Father, what a blessing it is to be here this morning. Father, we're here to sing praises to your name, to lift up your holy name that we might worship you in spirit and in truth. Father, you have created all things, you provided all things, you love each and every one of us with everlasting, unconditional, never-changing love. And we know it is your desire, your utmost desire, that all your children would come to a knowledge of the truth and be saved. That we might have the privilege of spending eternity in the presence of Jesus and holy angels and all those inhabitants of the unfallen worlds who at this very moment are listening and watching what's going on here on this sin-cursed planet, indeed the theater of the universe. Father, this morning we confess to you that we know that none of us is entitled to eternity and that the wages of sin is death, but eternal life is in Christ Jesus. Because you emptied all of heaven for our sakes. When Jesus came to this dangerous place and lived a perfect life and died a perfect death for each one of us. Help us this morning, Father, with the help of thy Holy Spirit, renew our commitment to Jesus and accept him without reservation this morning. Father, we're so thankful for all that you do for us each and every day, hour by hour, day by day, year by year, that we can't even begin to recall all that you've done for us. And we're so thankful for what you're doing in us and by your grace through us. We might share with others the everlasting gospel that has been entrusted to us as part of your remnant church here in these last days of Earth's history. Father, this morning we lift up a number of people this morning who have requested special prayer. We think of Brother Gerald Moretz, who had a fall and has a broken arm. We pray that you'd wrap your loving arms around him in a special way. Father, we think of Don Marie Real this morning at the loss of Lottie this past week. What a pillar of this church he was. What a precious soul. He loved everybody. He helped everybody. And he is being greatly missed even as we speak. Well, this morning we would ask that you would be with our pastor as he breaks the bread of life to us. And we pray the things that you have put upon his heart as he presents them to us would be exactly what we need to hear this morning, so that we might go forward from this place in faith this morning and share with others what he is about to share with us. Thank you for hearing and answering our prayers this morning. In the name of our Creator, our Redeemer, our Sustainer, Jesus. Amen.
I'm going to reverse what's in the bulletin. Is that okay? I was thinking it'd be a little easier because we're going to invite Noel and the boys to come up. We're going to be dedicating Coralie this morning. And I would like to invite the elders also, if you would come up, because I would like for the elders to be around this family, beautiful family that they have. And we just want to take a few moments this morning, and we want to just dedicate not just Coralie, but Mom and Dad to the duty that they have as parents. And just a couple of things I wanted to share. Noel and Elena, we are so glad that you have chosen to dedicate Coralie today. Even as you, Elena, are going to be baptized, what a beautiful Sabbath this is going to be. Amen? A beautiful Sabbath, a beautiful way to express your desire to serve God by dedicating your oldest child on the day you are making your public commitment of your desire to serve Him. Noel and Elena, you have a responsibility to Christ to bring up your children in the fear and the admonition of the Lord. The psalmist tells us that children are a treasure of the Lord. And you know what? Having had little opportunity to spend some time with you, I know that they truly are a treasure to you. And there is a thought that I wanted to share this morning from a book, Ministry of Healing, that is really places it in its right priority. It says, there is no more important field of effort than that committed to the founders and guardians of the home. No more work entrusted to human beings involves greater or more far-reaching results than does the work of fathers and mothers. And this morning, I know that you have a great opportunity and responsibility to your daughter and to the boys. As we dedicate Coralie, we are also dedicating both of you to follow through in leading her to trust and to love Jesus. Noel and Elena, is it your commitment today to lead Coralie to Jesus through your own lives? And I want to ask you, the congregation and their church family, is it your covenant today to also support this family in their work of raising their children to know the Lord? Amen. Amen. We want you to know as a family that we are here for you and with you. And Coralie, we know that God's already working in your life, and we are so thrilled to dedicate you to Him today. And I'm going to ask if we can just come out a little bit, and if we can just kneel right here in a little family circle, would that be okay? Come over here just a little further out so we can get the elders around you, okay? And we are going to ask God to bless your family and to bless you in raising Coralie and these boys. Let's pray. Our loving Father in heaven, we are so thankful for this family and their dedication to want to serve you and to follow you. But not only to want to serve and to follow you, but to want to bring their children up to know and to love you. And so I pray, Father, that you will be with Noel and Elena, that you will guide them, that you will give them wisdom, help them to know how to reach out to their children, to reveal the love of Jesus to them. And as they lead out in their family, I pray that today as we dedicate Coralie to you, Father, that her life today, from this day forward, she will start sensing you even closer than ever before. That she will know that there is a God that loves her, that cares for her, and that wants to be her personal friend. So I pray that you will bless her in this way today. We dedicate her and this family to you today, Lord, and that you will move mightily through Coralie and through her parents as they seek to bring her up in your faith and your love. So we thank you for hearing our prayer. We look forward to how you're going to work. And I also, Lord, dedicate this church to the work that we have to do in supporting this family and encouraging them to be there for them when there are times of trial and struggle. So, Lord, I pray that you will bless in all that is done, and may your spirit be sensed in this family. May they be a living witness and testimony for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
All right, I guess I don't want to do that because Elena's going to have to talk. So you can come right here. I'll let you go into the pulpit area.
Okay.
And don't get lost in there. Whatever you do, don't get lost in there. But now I'm going to go through her baptismal vows with her. And one of the things that has struck me recently is that we want to make sure that people understand that when we go through the baptismal vows, if there is anyone here that's a young person or you decide that you would like to be baptized, I want you to understand baptismal vows are not a test. Did you hear what I said? They're not a test. This is something for you to make a commitment to, and it doesn't mean that you are perfect. This is the most important thing that I want you to know, is that when you commit to being baptized, you are not saying you're going to be perfect. You are saying that you want to commit your heart and your life to Jesus, and you want to give him all that you are and all that you have. And so that's what baptism is really all about. When we come into and we join a church, our vows are so that we understand what the church believes. And I would not want anyone to come into a church and not understand what the church believes that they're becoming a member of. Does that make sense? So I'm just wanting to make sure that we always share the vows with our baptismal candidates, not as a test for them, but to make sure that they understand what they're accepting and the commitment that they're making to God's church as well. So, Elena, as I go through these vows, just like you did at your wedding, you will say, I do. Okay? So do you believe that there is one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, a unity of three co-eternal persons?
I do.
Do you accept the death of Jesus Christ on Calvary as the atoning sacrifice for your sins and believe that through faith in his shed blood, you are saved from sin and its penalty?
I do.
Do you renounce the world and its sinful ways? And have you accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, believing that God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven your sins and given you a new heart?
I do.
Do you accept by faith the righteousness of Christ as your intercessor in the heavenly sanctuary and accept his promise of transforming grace and power to live a loving, Christ-centered life in your home and before the world?
I do.
Do you believe that the Bible is God's inspired word, the only rule of faith and practice for the Christian? Do you covenant to spend time regularly in prayer and Bible study?
I do.
Do you accept the Ten Commandments as a transcript of the character of God and a revelation of his will? Is it your purpose by the power of the indwelling Christ to keep this law, including the fourth commandment, which requires the observance of the seventh day of the week as the Sabbath of the Lord and the memorial of creation? Do you look forward to the soon coming of Jesus and the blessed hope when this mortal shall put on immortality? As you prepare to meet the Lord, will you witness of his loving salvation and by your life and word help others to be ready for his glorious appearing?
I do.
Do you accept the Bible teaching of spiritual gifts and believe that the gift of prophecy is one of the identifying marks of the remnant church? And do you believe in church organization? Is it your purpose to support the church by tithes and offerings and by your personal effort and influence?
I do.
Do you believe that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit and you will honor God by caring for it, by avoiding the use of that which is harmful, abstaining from all unclean foods, from the use, manufacture, or sale of alcoholic beverages, the use, manufacture, or sale of tobacco in any of its forms for human consumption, and from the misuse or trafficking of narcotics or drugs?
I do.
That's a big one. Our world has definitely changed, hasn't it? Okay, so number 11 says, I know and understand the fundamental Bible principles as taught by the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and I purpose by God's grace to fulfill his will by ordering my life in harmony with those principles. And I accept the New Testament teaching of baptism by immersion and desire to be so baptized as a public expression of faith in Christ and his forgiveness of my sins.
I do.
And lastly, I accept and believe that the Seventh-day Adventist Church is the remnant church of Bible prophecy, and the people of every nation, race, and language are invited and accepted into its fellowship, I desire to be a member of this local congregation of the World Church.
I do.
I do. Amen. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Now, I've asked Elena if she will just share a little bit. I think it's really good for us to know how a person journeyed or got to the place where they finally wanted to make that commitment to Jesus. And she's going to take just a minute now and share with you what God has done with her and how she came to this point.
Thank you. Happy Sabbath. I'm going to try to get through this. I feel overwhelmingly blessed to be here today to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, my Savior. Not doing so good. Had you told me about 10 years ago that on this day I would be standing in the house of God being baptized, I would have called you crazy. I was born and raised in central New Jersey, where at that time people were either Catholic, Jewish, or formerly practicing either of those two options. My parents were both raised Catholic, so they raised us, myself, my sister, and my two brothers Catholic as well. I even went to Catholic elementary school. Looking back at that time, it astonishes me that we never read the Bible in school. That's in Catholic school. We would read excerpts from the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but never any of the books outside of those, and definitely not from the Old Testament. In my early teenage years, my parents separated and divorced. Divorce was not yet as common as it is now. I am older than I look. It was an extremely hard time for us, for me. I understand now, as an adult, that my parents were doing the best they could under the circumstances, but as a young teenager, I felt alone, abandoned, unloved, sad, angry, and most of all, rejected. Unfortunately, turning to the church community I had been a part of my entire life was not an option. Because in their own pridefulness, they basically kicked us out to not tarnish their own image in association with my parents' divorce. For me, this was an enduring oppression of God's people. Life went on. I grew up, went to college, got a job, got married relatively young at 22 years old, and then had my daughter, Coralie. I moved from New Jersey to California to North Carolina. I did not have a relationship with God. I had good times and bad, just like most people do, but in the bad times, I suffered from severe rejection. Some of it was without merit, my own anxiety, but some of it was. In 2016, my 10-year marriage ended because of the greatest betrayal marriage could have. I was crippled with feelings of abandonment, and I grieved the loss of nearly every aspect of my life. I not only lost my marriage, and in many ways my identity, but I also lost seemingly every single person that had claimed to love me for over 10 years as well. I was forced to pick up the pieces of my life off the floor. I moved Coralie and myself into a new house in Kernersville and set out to rediscover myself. I had a plan. I could do this on my own. I don't need anybody. And that was all true for about 5 weeks when I found myself again back on the floor bleeding to death on my new driveway. In September 2017, I was carrying a 70-inch frameless bathroom mirror from my garage to a van belonging to a lady from Craigslist who was purchasing the mirror. Halfway down the driveway, the mirror split between my hands, and the top half came down like a guillotine, slicing the inside of my elbow, severing my bicep tendon and brachial artery. I looked down and saw a strong squirt of blood shoot out from the inside of my arm. I very calmly placed my hand on my wound and raised my arm above my head. I do not know how I knew to do this. The Craigslist lady immediately went into shock and said she was going to go to the kitchen to get a paper towel. I said, no, you need to call 911. She would not come near me and moved very slowly. She said that her phone was in her van at the end of the driveway, so I walked down with her, but I was quickly getting very weak and told her that I needed to lay down. Thankfully, my across-the-street neighbor had heard the shattering glass, and when he looked out his window and saw me laying on the driveway, he came running over to help. He didn't know what to do, so I told him to rip his shirt, tie it around my hand on the wound, and then use his hands to press into mine because I was getting too weak to apply my own pressure. I do not know how I knew to do this. The sky was very blue that day, and it wasn't too hot. There were just a few of those big, puffy white clouds in the sky. As I laid on the driveway looking up, I heard someone talking to me. He told me that it was not my time to die, that I was meant for great things. I was calm and feeling very at peace, which was interrupted by seemingly the entire first response team of Winston-Salem and Kernersville. I was only in the ER at Baptist for about 10 minutes when I was rushed to the operating room. My labs after surgery showed that I lost 2 liters of blood. I was lucky to be alive, if you believe in luck, and we know better, right? Prior to my injury, I had started going to a local gym for stress management, but exercise for rehabilitation was even more important now that I was injured. In less than 3 months, I had full use of my arm and hand and was inspired by my own recovery to become a personal trainer and help others, particularly women, on their own fitness journeys. I had worked at the gym only a few months when I met a very intriguing professional boxer. On our first date that I went with Noel, I met him at Golden Corral, and the first words out of his mouth when we sat down were, "Do you believe in God?" I didn't even have a second to think, and I blurted out yes, a response that even surprised myself. I fell in love with Noel, hearing him speak for hours about God and the Bible. I was captivated by the word, and that everything I thought I knew about it was completely inaccurate. Noel always said not to believe him, though, to read for myself, so I did. "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you." Matthew 6:33. And here we are today. I was never unloved. I was never abandoned. I was never rejected, not by my Father in heaven. He waited for me. He sought me out like one of his lost sheep. He welcomed me with open arms like the prodigal son. I am loved. I am whole. I am valued. But the very hairs on your head are all numbered. Fear ye not, therefore, ye are of more value than many sparrows. Matthew 10:30-31. I'd like to just close thanking Joan and Pat for the past year. They've met with me weekly for Bible study, and it's been wonderful getting to know them and learning more about our Lord. And I'd also like to thank Pastor and Joni, because they've truly been a blessing. Getting here today to be baptized was an obstacle in itself, and they've been so welcoming and understanding, and our church is very blessed to have them. Amen. Thank you. Happy Sabbath.
Wonderful testimony, right? Of God's love. I felt his love this week when it would rain, and I hurried to add some more seeds to the ground, because no matter how much I water, they don't come up. And then a thunder came, and I was like, oh, started a little bit to fear, but that's not the fear that stayed more than 2 seconds. I said, "Lord, you're telling me you're right here with your power, with your love." I immediately felt loved. So in response to that love, what do? We choose the fear of the Lord, which means staying away from sin and always serving Jesus. Let's sing.
Fear of the Lord.
He will
choose the way of the Lord. We choose the way of the Lord. He who delights in the word of the Lord shall be blessed in all of his ways. For the friendship with God is with those who
to be true, more consecration for work he needs me.
Now I invite you to stand and sing together another wonderful song, I Will Sing of Jesus' Love, the introduction for our worship.
Well, is this exciting or what?
Amen.
This is my first baptism here at Kernersville, so that's even more exciting for me. I do want to let you know that Gabrielle is going to be getting baptized on our homecoming Sabbath, and we have a couple of other people that may be making the decision to do something here, so we may see this baptismal tank pretty busy this month. I think that's good, don't you?
Amen.
We should be praising the Lord for that. And I want to just say I've been privileged to get to know Elena and Noel and their family. And it's not because Coralie thinks I'm a great guitar player. It has nothing to do with that. But I've just been really blessed to get to know them. And the one thing that has really spoke to my heart is that I see in Noel and Elena two people who have really wanted to get close to Jesus. And I see it in her life, I see it in Noelle's, and you know, I think that I'm thankful that Elena shared her testimony with us this morning, because we know what she's been through, we get to know her a little better, and it just shows us how God works in our lives, doesn't it? And so, Elena, because you have made that decision to give your heart and your life and commit it to Jesus today, It's my privilege this morning to baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. I want to just say, if there's anybody that is considering baptism, if you would love to be baptized or to study for baptism, please talk to myself or one of the elders. We would love to get you started and get you ready for that process of entering into the kingdom of heaven. Let's go ahead and bow our heads for prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for this decision that Elena has made, and we just pray that you will bless her, that you will keep her in your care, and that you will continue to guide her as she seeks to follow you in all that she does. Bless their home and their family, and bless this church as we continue to minister to others. For we ask it in Jesus' name, amen. I want to apologize because in the middle of all my excitement, I want to ask Noel if he would stand. I don't know what happened to Joan and Pat. Where'd they go? Oh, there they are. If you guys would just stand, normally we would ask the people to stand that have been involved. So Noel, if you and the family and Joan and Pat, and Elena has asked that Joni would be her spiritual mentor. So Joni, if you'll stand, I know that Joan and Pat and Noel have had a tremendous influence in Elena's life. And so I just want to thank them personally. And I know God is using all three of you in different ways. But I want to thank you and appreciate so much what you've done for Elena. I know that she does as well. God bless.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. What a high Sabbath it is. A dedication and a baptism. I just pray that we get to see and hear more testimonies like that. You know, I think about what does it take for it to result in a day like today, and it kind of brings us, it's very fitting that today's worship and tithe and offerings is for Carolina evangelism. It's evangelism, and I think that bears the question, what is evangelism? Last week, Jonathan Peters and I had the privilege to be down in Alabama visiting a place called Living Springs, and I know several of you here have been here there before and are familiar with it, but it's a health retreat down there, and one thing that I think we both witnessed was what it looks like to see true missionaries at work, people who have dedicated their lives to sharing the message. And they do that through health. And evangelism can come in many forms. It can be a small group where people gather and find a safe place to fellowship and get to know the Lord. It can be formal meetings here where a young man and young lady, one who grew up in the church and another who knew nothing about it, are invited to participate and brought back into the fold. It can be God's closet, where we clothe children and share the love of Jesus. But one thing that all evangelism has in common is it requires our participation, our time, our resources, and our monies. So this morning, I pray that you give generously to evangelism so we can finish the work and Jesus can come take us home. Amen? All right, let's pray. Lord, we are so grateful and richly blessed this morning to get to be a part of these stories and get to witness these testimonies. And Lord, you bless us so richly in so many ways. And I just pray that you lay on our hearts the generosity and faith to give back to your work. In Jesus' name.
what you can control. Let me take it for you. Now what's your hurry? Why the big hurry? We've got all the time in the world. Quick, got minutes. Well, I got days. You got seconds. Well, I've got ways. You're out of options. Well, still got thousands. Tell me what's your problem? Whoa. What's your worry? Why the big hurry? Yeah, you got all the time in the world. So why don't you let go of what you can't control? Let me take it for you. Now what's your worry? Why the big hurry? I've got all the time in the world.
It's now time for our lamb's offering. If the kids would head to the back and get their baskets, and remember to give generously to this as well.
Well, good morning, boys and girls. I am so happy to see each and every one of you here today. Oh, can someone tell me what you think is in this box? Cheerios? Kind of sounds like Cheerios. All right, Sarah, come help me. Hold the bowl. Let's pour some Cheerios in, right? Cheerios, and our eyes and our ears told us that this was cereal, but it was not cereal. Now what about this box? What do you think's in this box? You think this is Cheerios? Are you sure? The other box was crayons. Are we sure this is cereal? All right, let's see. Oh, I am so glad this one's Cheerios. Whew, that makes me happy. You know, sometimes things aren't really as they appear to be. And we can't be sure that our eyes and ears are truly seeing and hearing things the way that they are. There is one thing we can always be sure of, and that is that God loves you, and he loves you, and you, and you, and you, and all of you back there too. Jesus, God loves us all. You know, the Bible tells us about this in Hebrews 11, 1.
Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence things not seen.
That's right. It says that faith is to be sure of the things that we have not seen. God is as sure as this box of cereal that always has cereal in it. And when you have faith in God, you can trust him. And you can believe that he will always take care of you. All right, can we fold our hands? All right. Dear Jesus, we want to have faith in you. Teach us to believe in you and trust you even though we can't see you. And thank you for always loving us. Amen. All right, I've got a little something here for you guys, too.
Yeah. Happy Sabbath, everybody. Today's scripture reading will be in the book of John chapter 4, verses 9 to 14. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, How is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me, which am I a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, If thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, Give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. The woman saith unto him, Sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well, and drank thereof himself, and his children, and his cattle? Woo! Jesus answered and said unto her, Whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. Thank you, and happy Sabbath again.
Yeah. I'm thinking that was a sermon. What do you think? I know who to look for my next guest speaker. This morning, I want to talk to you for just a few minutes about something that really has impacted me in the last 2 weeks. I want to talk to you about going deep at the well. And I want you to think about that term, deep at the well, because we're going to be looking at a story in just a few minutes that I think will really impact your life. But I want to begin by asking you a question. Have you ever made a decision in your life that was probably a poor decision, and you knew that it was probably going to lead you in a direction that you didn't want to go and you wouldn't want to be, but you still made the decision to go that way anyway? Maybe I could even say that you were lured into some kind of sin that you knew you were going to regret down the road, but there was that moment of instant gratification that led you to follow through, and then all of a sudden you got to a place where you felt like you were in this deep hole that you were never going to be able to climb out of. Have you ever had that experience? I'm going to say something that's very personal right now, but I want this message to be personal. You may be experiencing something right now that you would be ashamed if other people knew, that you would be afraid to even talk to someone about, because you wouldn't want anyone to see beyond that cover that you have. I hope this morning that as you listen to this message, that you will do what I have had to do in my life, and that is come to Jesus and say, Lord, I've really messed up. I really need you to help me. I want you to bow your heads with me as we begin. Our loving Father in heaven, this morning as we are gathered here in this place, Lord, we all come from different backgrounds. We have all gone through different experiences in our lives. And there are many of us in this room right now who have suffered a lot of hurt at the hands of those who have gone contrary to your will. But Lord, there are also some of us sitting here today that are struggling with something in our lives, and we need to know that there is an answer, there is a remedy, that Jesus has the power to give us victory over whatever it is that is separating us from him. So I pray that as we look at this story together this morning, I pray for a special outpouring of your Holy Spirit. Lord, you need a church that's going to be ready to greet you when you come. We need to understand that if we want to spend eternity with you, then we are going to need to let go of everything that this world has to offer and to rely solely upon you. So I pray for your Holy Spirit to move upon our hearts. Lord, you know how inadequate I am. And I know that without you, I could not even begin to present this message today. So I'm asking that you will come into my heart, that you will fill me with your Spirit. Use me as a vessel in your hand. Hide me behind the cross. And let Jesus be glorified today. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. In Romans chapter 6 and verse 23, the Bible says that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. You see, we all understand what sin is all about. Sin is what caused Adam and Eve to have to be removed from the garden. Sin is what separated us from God. Isaiah 59 and verse 2 tells us that sin, our sin, has separated us from God. I don't know about you this morning, but I don't want to be separated from God. And I know it's not on God's end that the separation has happened. You see, sin causes me to look in a different direction, to think that I am going to find some kind of gratification in another place other than the only one that can give me satisfaction and peace, and that's Jesus. Just on Thursday morning, I guess it was Thursday or was it Friday morning, Joni and I took a walk. We went for a prayer walk in Triad Park. How many have been to Triad Park? You know, there's a lot of places you can walk there, but there's one loop that's kind of in the middle. It's not real long, but nobody's in there because of the bugs and the spider webs. And so we go through there, and we walk in the morning sometimes, and we'll do a few loops while we pray together. And when we finished our walk, we went over to the big the pavilion that's right across the street from that section, and there were a lot of tables there, and Joni and I were just going to stretch a little bit and finish off our time. And so as we were doing that, I kept hearing this. Now, I thought it was a squirrel on the roof of the building, because it's a metal roof, and I thought it was a squirrel on the metal roof, and it just kept going and kept going and kept going. And Joni said, "There is a squirrel in that garbage can." I said, "What? I thought it was on the roof." She said, "No, listen." And I listened, and sure enough, there was a squirrel in the garbage can. Now, this is one of those big, round, 50-gallon drums that has the round lid on it and then the round top that's got the flopping door, right? So this squirrel was pretty good because he could climb up the plastic bag inside, he could hold on with one paw, and he could halfway open that door, but he couldn't get it to stay open because the minute he let go to step through, it closed again. So that poor squirrel was there for at least 10 minutes while we were there. So I went over and I thought, okay, I'm going to help him. Now, I want you to be paying attention to what I'm telling you, because we're going to see the analogy in this story. So the squirrel is in the garbage can, and I walk over, and I don't want to scare him. I don't want to invade too much. So I just put my hand over the top and push the door open. What do you think he did? He went straight down to the bottom. He didn't want to have anything to do with anything that was connected with a human hand. And so then I thought, okay, well, if I don't do something, he's never going to get out of there because he can't get out on his own. So then I took the whole lid, I lifted it off, and I set it over on the ground, and I stood there, and all of the light was shining in. You know how the light shines into darkness when Jesus comes to help us. And so the light was shining in, but the squirrel still didn't do anything. He stayed hovered down in the bottom of that garbage can because he knew I was standing beside the can. So I said, okay, there's only one way that I'm going to get this squirrel out. And so I went over and I grabbed the garbage can and I leaned the garbage can over away from me so he couldn't see me anymore, but he could see the trees and he could see the grass. And within seconds, flew out, jumped out, took off running out into the bushes. But now, I want you to realize something. That squirrel was just like you and me, because we can't save ourselves. Well, sometimes we like to think we can, and we may get up to the top of the garbage can, and we may claw around, and we may say, I'm almost there, but we can't save ourselves. We need a Savior. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Aren't you thankful for Jesus this morning? I want to take you to a story this morning that has really, really moved on my heart. I want you to go with me in your Bibles to John chapter 4, John chapter 4, and I want you to look with me at one of the most beautiful stories that I think I have ever read, and especially as I began to study it more, I began to realize how beautiful this story is, because this story is a story of redemption. It's a story of restoration. It's a story of rescue. A story that clearly reveals to you and me the desire of our Creator. It's a story that points out clearly, listen now, it is a story that points out clearly the pain, the embarrassment, the discouragement, the shame that poor decisions and poor choices can make in our lives when we allow the pressures of the world to overwhelm us and draw us into its snares. This morning we are going to talk about going deep at the well. John chapter 4, beginning in verse 1. John says, "When therefore the Lord knew how the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself baptized not, but his disciples, he left Judea and departed again unto Galilee. And he must needs go through Samaria. Then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. Jesus travels to Galilee. Nothing unusual about that, except for the fact that normally the Jews hated the Samaritans so much, they would not go through Samaria. They would go around by the edge of Samaria and go on down into Galilee, but they wouldn't set foot in Samaria if it was all possible. I want you to notice immediately in verse 4, we talk about divine appointments all the time. I want you to notice in verse 4, it says, he must needs go to Samaria. Jesus didn't need to go to Samaria. Jesus didn't need to do anything. Jesus had a divine appointment planned, and you need to understand this very clearly. Meeting that woman at the well was no coincidence at all. Jesus not only planned to meet the woman at the well, he knew exactly what time he needed to be at the well so that he would be there when she came. This is something that we need to remember, is that there are no coincidences when God works. Do you believe that this morning? There are no coincidences when God is working. If God's hand is over it, then it is going to move according to his infinite will and providence. So Jesus comes to the well, and he sits down. The Bible tells us that he's wearied from his journey, and obviously he is thirsty, and we are told that it's the sixth hour, which we know from various different studies that it's about 12 noon. It's right smack in the middle of the day, and what is the middle of the day usually in the summertime? It's pretty much the hottest part of the day. So they've been walking all the way down from Jerusalem. They've been walking, and they've been going in the heat of the day, and Jesus is hot, and he's tired. And there's some good news in that, and I want you to go with me to see what that is. Hold your finger there in John and go to Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 14. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 14. There's a reason why we are told what took place there, why John gives us some of this information that he did. Hebrews 2, beginning verse 14. In Hebrews 2, 14, Paul tells us, for as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he, Christ, also himself, likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. For verily he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Wherefore in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be, now listen, he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself hath suffered being tempted, he is able to succor them that are tempted. Aren't you thankful for that? The Bible points out over and over again to us that Jesus was fully human and he was fully divine. You and I can't explain that, but Jesus never used his divinity to help himself, did he? Never once did he use divinity to help himself. So now here we find him at this well. He is thirsty, he is tired, the well is deep, and he has nothing with to draw. So there are two very important things that I want us to remember as we go through this story. Two very important things for us to learn. Number one, we will see what sin, discouragement, poor choices do in the heart of a sinner, and how God wants to remedy the problem. And number two, we are going to see the process, and this is so beautiful. If you want to spread the word, then you need to be paying attention to how Jesus worked with this woman at the well. We will see how the process of winning the woman of Samaria deserves our most careful study and attention on the part of anyone who wants to win souls for Christ. So let's begin. And I want you to know that as you go through this story with me, we're going to see how those two points intertwine and blend together. There are four beautiful stages that the Bible commentary brings out that Jesus used in this process of bringing this woman to him. So let's go at verse 7 and go on to verse 15 and look a little further into the story. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away into the city to buy meat. Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, how is it that thou being a Jew asketh drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, if thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked him if he would have given thee living water. The woman saith unto him, sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is what? The well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well, and drank thereof himself, and his children, and his cattle? Jesus answered and said unto her, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up to everlasting life. The woman saith unto him, sir, give me this water, that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. Now, there's a few things that I want you to see in this section. First of all, the first method that Jesus used was awakening a desire in her heart for something better. But Jesus did it by doing something that was beautiful. He asked her for a favor. Have you ever asked a neighbor or a stranger of a favor and noticed what happens in their heart and in their demeanor when they treat you or talk with you? When you ask somebody, you know, Joni and I moved into a neighborhood, and the neighbor behind us came over one day to introduce himself, and he brought one single rose to give to my wife. He's a very nice older man. I can say older now because I'm kind of in that category, I guess. But he was an older guy, and he was very, very nice guy. And so one day I needed something that I didn't have, and I knew that he had what I needed. And so I went over to his house, and I asked him if it would by any chance I could borrow this item just for a little bit. And you know, the smile came on his face, and we went out to his garage, and he got this item for me, and he gave it to me. And it was so awesome, because what happened in that moment was a complete transformation in our relationship. All of a sudden, he was always wanting to help me. But what was even neater is that he would come to me when he wanted help. And then one day, he was out in his backyard, and he was working on a trailer, and I saw him, and I said, I'm going to go out and talk to my friend. And so I went out, his name was Dave, and I went out and I talked to him, and I said, so what's going on out here? And I could tell he was really down, and I said, what happened? He said, my 38-year-old son passed away. And so right then, my heart was breaking for him, and right then, I said, can I pray with you? And he said, sure. And so we prayed together right there at that trailer. And you know, from that day on, he would come to my house. He would come around and knock on the front door. And he would say, Ralph, he said, my friend George is going to go in. He's got diabetes, and they're going to have to cut his toes off. Can we pray for George? We began to be praying partners, as it were. If there was anything going on, we would pray together about it. Jesus asked that woman for one thing. He made a request for water, and it turned her heart to begin looking at him different immediately. Because you know the story of Samaritans and Jews. They hated each other. The Jews looked down on the Samaritans, second-class citizens. They didn't want to have anything to do with them. But yet Jesus was asking this woman if she would give him something to drink. And this is what the book Desire of Ages says. The Savior was seeking to find a key to this heart with the tact born of divine love. He asked, not offered, a favor. He wanted to gain her attention with his request. Having gained her attention, Jesus aroused her interest by offering her living water. And although she doesn't fully understand the point, she is beginning to desire the water that he offers. And as you know, there are reasons why she would like to have that water. She did not like coming to that well. Why do you think she came at noon every day? Because all of the other women came in the morning in the cool of the day to get their water. She didn't want to be around the other women because she didn't have the best reputation in town. She was looked down upon as a second-class citizen. She was a lonely person, but she was ashamed of what she had done in her life and where she was currently at. But it was a situation which maybe you understand what I'm talking about. It was a situation where she felt like there was no way out. I have to exist where I'm at. But now all of a sudden she meets this stranger, this man that starts talking to her about a living water and something that she will never have to drink again. Her mind immediately starts thinking to, I won't have to come back to this well anymore and be ashamed. I won't have to worry about this well. I'll have this eternal water that he's offering. She didn't understand the water, but Jesus was calling her to a desire for something that she did not have. I want you to know this morning, and you may already, but it's powerful what shame and guilt can do to a person. Jesus has aroused a desire in her for something better. She's slowly beginning to engage in the real conversation. And now he begins to do the next thing. He begins to awaken the conviction of her personal need. Look with me now at verse 16 through 20. Jesus saith unto her, go call thy husband and come hither. The woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said unto her, thou hast well said, I have no husband. For thou hast had five husbands, and he whom thou now hast is not thy husband. In that thou saidst truly. The woman saith unto him, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is a place where men ought to worship. Now all of a sudden, Jesus starts to hit home. And I want you to think about your own experience. Sometimes I think we actually have convinced ourselves that we can hide a sin from God. We somehow seem to think that, well, you know, if I don't pray or if I don't go talk to God, then, you know, this thing, I can stay in where I'm at, and I really don't have to think about whether it's right or wrong. You see, this is what was going on in her mind. Jesus had brought a desire for something better, but now he's starting to bring a conviction to her heart. When he started letting her know that, hey, listen, I know a little bit more about your life than you think. She started thinking to herself, okay, I don't want to talk about my situation with men. So I'm going to turn this in a different direction. And so in verse 20 there, she goes back to a religious thing. Well, our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and you say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Now, what I love about Jesus and what we could all learn is that Jesus let her take the conversation for a little while. He let her kind of start making a conversation, but he was still going to be taking her back. He was still going to be going a little deeper with her. And so after he awakens this desire for her, he awakens this need of, this personal need of conviction, he blows his conversation wide open as he continues to move beyond the surface conversation much deeper to her heart and her greatest need, which was himself. He focuses on the secrets of her life. Do you have any secrets this morning? She's not ready to receive the living water. There are stagnant waters of sin that first need to be removed. She prefers not to discuss her private affairs with a stranger. Jesus acknowledges her statement, but he reveals he knows far more about her than she is willing to reveal herself. Thus, he convinces her that he is a prophet. And she once again shifts the conversation from herself to this topic of general religion. This morning, like every soul convicted of sin, she seeks to escape. She's looking for a way out of having to address the real problem. But the old life of sin has got to be removed before the new life of righteousness can begin. I want you to hold your finger there and go with me to Romans chapter 6. We just had a baptism today, and we had a young lady commit her heart and her life to Jesus. And I'm so grateful for that. In Romans chapter 6, we are reminded of what it looks like and what has to take place before Jesus can actually come into our heart, because, you know, we can't have two masters sitting on the throne of our hearts. And notice what it says in Romans chapter 6, beginning in verse 1. Paul says, "What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism unto death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin." Jesus, having awakened a desire for something better in her life, whatever that may be for her, and a conviction of her personal need for it, he now proceeds to guide her to a point of making a decision. And you see, right now, sitting here in this room right now, if you're struggling with something, Jesus wants you to make a decision. He doesn't sit there condemning you. He sits there just like he did with that woman, patiently talking and trying to help you understand that what you need in your life is not the things that have overcome you in this world. What you need in your life is Jesus Christ to abide in your heart. He proceeds to guide her to a point of decision by bringing her wandering thoughts into focus, by defining what true religion really is, and then he extends her an invitation to become a true worshiper. He calls for a decision to acknowledge him as the true Messiah. So look with me at 21 to 26 now. John 4, 21 to 26. "Jesus saith unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshiper shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. The woman saith unto him, I know that the Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. When he has come, he will tell us all things." And I love this. "Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto thee am he." Can you imagine? Can you imagine what must have been going on in her heart and her mind? All of a sudden, he just simply says, "You've said it yourself, and here I am. I'm right here sitting at the well with you. You're worried about how deep the water is. I'm worried about getting deep into your heart to change your life today forever." He said, "I that speak unto thee am he." Wow. He spoke to her heart. He drew her to desire something more than she had in her current situation. He led her to the conviction of her own personal need. He clearly revealed who he was. He plainly showed her that he can read the heart. Nothing is hid from him. Will we acknowledge him today as our Lord and Savior? How do you see Jesus this morning? Do you really think that you can hide something from him? The reader of hearts does not condemn. He came not to condemn, but to redeem. He does seek to reveal our sin so that he can free us from it, because sin separates us from him. He wants to forgive, to cleanse, to restore, but we must confess, repent, and turn to him. He will not force his way into our hearts, but he does stand at that door and he knocks. Once we acknowledge our need, we turn to him and make the decision to let him fix our broken lives. I don't know about you, but we've all got something in our lives. We're all broken. And don't try to think that you're some, you know, masculine guy or you're some woman that's just strong as nails. Trust me, you have an area of your life that is broken. The devil has tried to make sure of that. And he wants you to continue to live in that brokenness. But once we acknowledge our need, we turn to him and make the decision to let him fix our broken lives. Then he begins to heal, to restore, and then he calls for a response. The final thing he did with this woman at the well was he called for an action appropriate to her decision. And what was the action? The action was go and tell someone else what I've done for you. Our testimony is the greatest thing that we have to share with the world. And look in verses 28 and 30 at what she said. The woman then left the water pot and went her way into the city and saith to the men. Interesting, she went to the men. Come see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is not this the Christ? And then down in verses 39 through 42. And many of the Samaritans of the city believed on him for the saying of the woman, which testified, he told me all that I ever did. So when the Samaritans were come unto him, they besought him that he would tarry with them, and he abode there 2 days. And many more believed because of his own word, and said unto the woman, we believe not because of thy saying, for we now have heard him ourselves, and know that he is indeed the Christ, the Savior of the world. Isn't that beautiful? I mean, think about Elena. Elena was hearing about Jesus, but then as everyone studied with her, she began to study herself. She began to hear Jesus talking to her herself. She began to develop that own relationship with Jesus. And now she goes to Jesus. She comes to him to touch her heart and draw her closer. The call to action is to tell others what Jesus has done for us, to go, to teach, to make disciples, to make a difference, to spread the word. Jesus is coming soon. Today, are you struggling with something that is keeping you from Jesus? Are you holding on to the world thinking that it will be your security? Are you hiding something deep in your heart that you're ashamed to even bring to Christ? Remember, he is the reader of hearts. Nothing is hid from him. But he does not condemn. He merely seeks to reveal to the sin-broken heart the need for something better, to lead us to the conviction of our need, to call us to make a good decision, because you and I have the power of choice. And he gives us the opportunity to choose to serve him. When we make that decision, like the woman at the well, we can't help but want to tell someone else what he's done for us. He has set us free, and when we have the way, the truth, and the life, we are freed indeed. Let the power of his grace this morning transform your life. It is by grace through faith that we are saved, not of ourselves. Let him do his good work in you. And I want you to think about that grace as you listen to this song in closing this morning.
Time measured out my days, life carried me along. In my heart I yearned to follow God, but knew I'd never be so strong. I looked hard at this world, learn how heaven could be gained. Just to end where I began, where human effort is all in vain. Were it not for grace, I can tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me. I know how that would go. The battles I would face, forever running but losing the race, were it not for grace. So here is all my praise, expressed with all my heart, offered to a friend who took my place and ran a course I could not start. And when he saw in full just how much his love, final mile between me and heaven, so I would not be lost. Were it not for grace, I can tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me. And I know how that would go. The battles I would face, forever running but losing race, were it not for grace. Forever running but losing the race, were it not for grace.
As our group is coming up for our closing song, I want to invite you to bow your heads with me as we close. And I want you to think about what we talked about today and to really think in your heart. Is there something I need to give to Jesus that I just keep holding on to, thinking that I can handle it myself? I think we all realize that there have been so many obstacles in our lives that we would have failed had we not had Jesus with us. Hold on to Jesus this morning. Give him everything that you have. Open your heart completely. He doesn't want to condemn you. He wants to redeem you. Let's pray. Our loving Father in heaven, we are so thankful for all that you do for each one of us. Lord, as we looked at this story this morning, we realized that you are the reader of hearts. We don't need to try to come up with discussions or conversations that will lead us off in some direction. You want to go deep to the very heart of the issue. You want to speak to the suffering that we are going through, to the trial that we face, to the temptation that we need to let go of. I pray, Father, that you will move mightily among your people today As we go home, may your Holy Spirit move on our hearts, and may we all be drawn closer to you and recognize that it is only by your grace that we will be able to stand by you in the kingdom of heaven. We thank you for hearing our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Join us in singing the last song.
God be with you till we meet again. By his counsel's guide uphold you. With his sheep securely fold.
Here I am again. I'm so excited about today that I'm forgetting half the things I'm supposed to do. First of all, you're all standing, so I think it's only fitting that we welcome Elena into our church fellowship, don't you? So all those in favor of having Elena as a member, let me hear a hearty amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. And I also want to also have Elena come back and join me at the back. And as you leave today, maybe you can just welcome her and let her know how glad we are that she's a part of our fellowship. Thanks.